In 1979, a strange bunch of people made a television programme. They didn't have a clue what they were doing, but that didn't stop them. They did it their own way, and it changed their lives. It revolutionised comedy. It was not the 9 o'clock news.
It was the show you wanted to watch, and to be part of it was the best time to be alive ever.
Can I put this into some sort of perspective? When I caught Gerald in 68, he was completely wild.
Wild? I was absolutely livid.
I was hanging on by my fingernails. What I now realise is that so was everyone else. You know, that we didn't really quite realise what we had.
It was an innocent time and a carefree time, you know, all for one and one for all.
Thank you, Cyril.
I had nothing to lose. I had nothing to lose to... I could take off anybody. I just wanted to do something funny.
American Express?
That'll do nicely, sir. And would you like to rub my tits, too?
Not the 9 o'clock, not the 9 o'clock, not the 9 o'clock news.
Abu Ben Adhem. May his tribe increase.
Awoke one night from a deep dream of peace.
And saw, within the moonlight in his room,
a child to your roses.
I remember watching it and going, where's this going? Where's this going? Where's this going? Oh my God, that's the funniest thing I've ever seen in my life. And I have no idea why that's the funniest thing I've ever seen in my life. Please do it again.
The angel heard and vanished. The next night...
It came again with a great awakening light.
And showed the names whom God of love had blessed. And lo...
I say, I don't
It's never too embarrassing to watch. I mean, you know, the quality of the stuff was pretty good.
Good afternoon. Can I help you, sir? Yes, I would like some deodorant, please. Ball or aerosol? Neither. I want it for my armpits.
It's got a kind of punchiness, which is kind of really quite shocking, that you don't quite know where it comes from. And it's somebody telling the truth. They're saying, I think this is great. I love this.
There's a lot to be said in favor of cannabis. Where was I?
You were aware that you were watching something that was, you know, a little bit on the edge, a bit naughty.
I'll have a jar of Keep It Up cream, please. No, on second thoughts, make that 2 jars. Only I'm feeling a bit randy this week.
Well, hello. And tonight I'm talking to Billy Connolly, a well-known Scottish comedian.
I regard it as a real feather in my cap, you know, and a real landmark in my life.
It's wonderful to see you, Grovel Grovel Slime, and it's great grovel of you to stop in on your short visit to our little country, Humble Humble, to talk to me, talk to me.
My pleasure, my pleasure.
I mean, when I look at clips of it, it looks to me like Thatcher's Britain making fun of itself. And, you know, if you look at the streets behind where those things are taking place, it's a scuzzy, run-down, unhappy country.
It was a very ugly period. There were riots and there was a lot of unemployment and a lot of anger.
Where there is discord, may we bring harmony. And where there is despair, may we bring hope.
Britain was a very place of great conflict at that time. For Constable Savage to come on and make fun of, you know, a policeman at that point, with those tensions that were going on, was a very necessary safety valve for society at that time.
I think that perhaps you're being a little overzealous.
Which charges do you mean, then, sir?
Well, for instance, this one. Loitering with intent to use a pedestrian crossing. Savage, maybe you're not aware of this, but it is not illegal to use a pedestrian crossing. Neither is smelling of foreign food an offence.
You sure, sir?
It was always a trick of the light because it was taken and reviewed as though it was a satirical program. But actually, a lot of the sketches could have gone out any time, any year, any place.
Do you have a biro, please? Thanks.
The thing we were really trying to avoid being like was Monty Python on the one hand and the Do Ronnies on the other hand.
She's very attractive, isn't she?
Isn't she? Yes, isn't she?
Yes, very attractive.
Isn't she? Yes.
My word, very, very, very attractive. Yes. Huh? Woof. What? Woof.
The two Ronnies didn't represent what we, the life that we lived. It was guys in blazers with gold buttons and cravats in cocktail bars. None of us had ever been in such a place. It was yokels with three X's on their smocks. You know, that wasn't our idea of farming. It was, you know, one man in a modern tractor. And, you know, if the two Ronnies ever went into a telephone box, which I'm sure they never did, but there would be a telephone in there with the telephone directory, and all the telephone boxes we went into were used as lavatories. That's what telephone boxes were for in the 70s.
It is about being in contemporary society, not just a series of fantasy jokes. The sketch about the guy waiting at the petrol station and he's trying to fill up his car to exactly to £5 and there's a man with a little button. When it gets to £5, he goes...
And you're just laughing yourself sick. It's just wonderful. It's wonderful. And that's what we tried to do with Not the Nine, to surprise ourselves, really, to, you know, to astonish ourselves with ideas that we would never have been able to think of on our own.
That is just the kind of bad language and, above all, endless references to parts of the body that are becoming, by their ceaseless repetition, knob in the media, just part and parcel and pubes of everyday conversation.
That for the past 200 years, the American people have conjoined with each other in a great quest for
harmony.
Harmony.
Democracy.
Democracy.
Freedom.
Freedom.
Cupcakes.
Cupcakes.
Look, Jonathan, I know these kids. I've worked in the areas we're talking about around Lambeth, Lewisham. I know their problems, I know their frustrations, lack of community facilities, I know their parents. And in my opinion, Professor Duff's suggestion that we should cut off their ghoulies is the only solution.
Absolutely. I mean, cut the ghoulies off. Cut them off.
True.
Well, there we have it.
Whip off the ghoulies.
Expert opinion seems to be in favour of cutting off their ghoulies.
It all began when BBC radio producer John Lloyd teamed up with Panorama producer Sean Hardy. Sean knew nothing about comedy, and John knew nothing about television. But they still thought it would be a good idea to make a comedy sketch show for television.
It started off being called Sacred Cows. That was the BBC's title for it. And it was designed to be a dissing of all the things that you weren't supposed to diss.
Here is the news.
There was such a thing as the 9 o'clock news, and it was a staple. It was like the nation's fireplace. It knew where it was, and there it was in the schedule every weekday. So the idea of something that running on the other side, on BBC Two, opposite it, had real meaning and cultural resonance to everybody in the country.
New Yorkers on their way to work this morning can find some tabloids on the newsstands, but not their usual morning papers, the New York Times and the Daily News.
In 1978, there was a strike at the New York Times, and a bunch of the journalists devised a thing called Not the New York Times, which was an absolutely brilliant, impeccable spoof, every typeface, every ad. You wouldn't have known until you went into it. And we slightly borrowed that. But it was a perfect title, Not the 9 o'clock News, because it told you the time, which was at 9 o'clock, and it was not the 9 o'clock news, and it was opposite the 9 o'clock news on one, so you couldn't really miss where it was.
The star of the show, Rowan Atkinson, had developed his unique style alongside two other students at Oxford University. They'd been a big hit at the Edinburgh Festival and would go on to conquer the world of comedy and film. Richard Curtis, the writing genius, would go on to write Four Weddings and a Funeral and create Blackadder with Rowan Atkinson, and together with musician Howard Goodall would write unforgettable comedy songs for Not the 9 o'clock News.
I was manning the, you know, the theatre or review stall at the Freshers' Fair at Oxford, and I remember this very curly-haired chap turning up saying that I do music, and it was Howard.
In my first week at university, I went to the Freshers' Fair, and I had decided that I wanted to be involved as a musician with the Comedy Review. So I went to the desk, and I said to the guy, look, I'd really like to be involved musically, I don't know how. We talked for a little bit, and he said, well, someone will come and see you. It turned out the guy behind the desk was Rowan Atkinson, and then when I went back to my room that afternoon, Richard Curtis came to see me, and he said, me and Rowan are doing a show, like a student review, in 3 weeks' time, in the Oxford Playhouse. Would you like to do the music? So I said, yeah.
I met Rowan in a sort of sketch writing unit that was meant to put on a show at the end of a summer term. And I thought he was a stuffed toy for the first 3 meters. He was so quiet.
And he famously has always described me as being like a cushion, in that I sat on the chair and I said nothing. And so that was our first meeting. I said very little, and I'm sure Richard said a great deal.
But then when finally we started to submit material, Rowan stood up and did two sketches and was clearly so much better than all the rest of us put together that I hung on to his coattails for a decade.
Are you mad? I asked.
The Oxford Review was billed as having, I think, 8 people in it. And by the time we got to see it, there were only 2 left, Rowan and Richard Curtis. And it was basically Rowan doing all the funny bits and Richard being the stooge. And almost from the first half minute of watching this show, you think, I'm in the presence of a genius.
Sediment. Soda. Tear. Under manager. Zob.
Undoubtedly, the Edinburgh Fringe was the sort of melting pot in terms of people seeing me and what I was doing, or what Richard Curtis and I, more accurately, were doing.
I'd seen him in Edinburgh when I, in my first year, I think, at university, gone to the Edinburgh Festival, and he did his one-man show there with Howard Goodall doing the music, and Richard Curtis being the other man in the one-man show. It's famous for not being one man, but of course it's a one-man show. And I mean, it blew my head off. I had never seen anything so fantastically funny in my life. I was simply weak with laughter.
We all thought, gosh, wow. There is very interesting and extraordinary idea as a performer.
Very closed down, eccentric person, really. Quite lonely looking, you know, very interested in machines and cars and quite shy, you know, quite shy.
I mean, I have a lot of fits of depression and lack of satisfaction, but they're nearly all associated with the entertainment industry and actually my other interests in life. I mean, silly things, but things I happen to enjoy doing a fantastic amount, like electronics, like driving trucks, are very simple. And the trouble with show business is that what you're doing, you're exposing yourself entirely, and your heart and soul is being torn out of you and shown to millions of people.
Rowan Atkinson was just the right man for John Lloyd's new show, but the nerdy electrical engineering student from Newcastle turned up with one of the most powerful agents in show business, the legendary Richard Armitage.
He came in with his agent, who was a very, some classic old-fashioned agent. He looked the part. He was sort of squat and enormously upper class, smoked cigars. He once said to me, I have all my combs made up by a little man in Geneva. I find only the Swiss know how to make a really good comb. And this is the man you were dealing with, incredibly powerful, John Cleese's agent. He represented David Frost's agent, most powerful agent in light entertainment in the country at that time. And he brought his boy in, Rowan, the young star. And they clearly thought this is going to be the Rowan Atkinson show. BBC management in those days was very powerful in its own right, and they were very sure of themselves. And although in the politest way, they said, this isn't going to be the Rowan Atkinson show, and here's our reasoning. We want to get some other talented people and put these other people around Rowan so that if he's good, he'll shine by comparison, and they'll support him. He won't have to carry the whole weight, and it also won't use up the material nearly so fast. And to do Richard Armitage and Rowan credit, they saw the point of that, and they bought into it.
And the rest is history.
Not the 9 o'clock news had found its shining star. A weird haircut on another Oxford student was the next thing to catch John Lloyd's eye.
We were all very scared of Mel, you know, he appeared to be so confident, you know. Anybody who can walk around with that haircut, you think, he must know something we don't know.
Does it not say in the good book, thou shalt part thy hair in the way of the Lord?
And thou shalt blow dry thy fringe and brush the layered sides in tantalizing waves to accentuate the auburn highlights of the crown, so shall ye. Who did this for you, then?
Essentially, in my second year at Oxford, I started to grow it absurdly long for a person whose hair is so thin as mine was. So I just kept it because it was a sort of like a sign. It's that pathetic. I just felt as though, you know, hey, this is me, you know. This is my hair, and I'm proud of it.
I don't even remember noticing Mel Smith's hair. I remember once when we were on location, seeing him in his underpants. And that was really weird.
We all liked Mel. Mel was quite a figure. He was a sort of... I think he had a car. This was 1979. He actually had a car. He actually drove himself around town. We were all in our 20s. We couldn't believe that. I had a bicycle.
John remembered a very bad sketch I'd done as part of the Oxford Review, which was doing just a nonsense version of Modern Major General from the Gilbert Sullivan. You know, I am the very diddle of a daddle diddle boggy gong, you know, whittle baggle boggly and doggly. It was just nonsense. And I didn't know what I was doing at the time, but it was bizarre to find out that John Lloyd thought, that's my man.
Everyone hands in the air! In the air, go on, keep him up! All right. Right now, nobody moves, nobody gets hurt, all right? 3 tenpenny stamps, please.
Mel Smith and his crazy hair boarded the 9 o'clock train to Comedy Town.
You're on television, aren't you?
Yes.
Up to this point, sketch comedy had been dominated by the Monty Python style of surreal acting. If they were to make their mark, this new show would have to do something completely different.
Not the 9 o'clock News was definitively negatively influenced by Monty Python. So the thing we took particular joy in was naturalistic performances because the Python style had been so high.
I mean, when John Lloyd asked me to do the program with him, I was kind of in some strange uppity way. Even though I needed the money, you know, £100 a program, yeah, I'll have that. But I was very, very concerned that we just didn't end up doing, you know, daft women in screechy voices and, you know, that kind of stuff.
One of the big differences with Not the Nine was that it was messier. You know, we wanted the dialogue to be much more realistic. In a way, even more realistic than a drama, much to sound much more like a television discussion with broken sentences and, you know, people sort of going and err and so forth. And that was very much something that Mel Smith brought to the program.
This week, we're going to take a look at origami, aren't we, Rowan? That's right, Mel, which is the ancient Japanese art of paper folding.
I remember lots of the sketches that we did together, like the origami sketch, in which we were just being very flat and very sort of you know, naturalistic to camera, which is something that I'd never done because I, you know, even then I was doing, I tended to do characters that were rather extreme, either extremely old or extremely silly or extremely young or facially very active. Whereas with Mel, I felt this wonderful sort of peace.
And I'll just start here, and Mel's just starting.
You can use absolutely any kind of any kind of paper for this. You can use
an old Radio Times, for instance. Just any old bit of paper.
And I'm just folding, you see, like this.
Folding it again over.
It's very, very simple.
It's very, very simple. It's an ancient Japanese art dating from centuries ago.
Now, if I make a tear like this and another tear like that. Now, you can do this on your own, but if there are two of you, then it probably will help. Now, we just have a pool there. That's it.
Now,
you see, now there, there we have a very nice hat.
Here's a little bracelet.
And here we have a nice pair of earrings.
And of course, a moustache.
And I think some of the naturalism was wonderful. I've got a particular favourite sketch, which was, if you can find it, was Rowan and Mel pretending to be identical twins. And you've never seen two people who look less like it. And they're just divine. They're like on Nationwide. And just the sort of little nervous laughter of two completely ordinary guys who just found themselves on this show.
In the studio now are two men who will tell us what it's like to suffer the pain and heartache of being identical twins. Right, now let's see if I can get it right. I've been trying to sort it out all afternoon. Brian, yes?
No, David, sorry.
Sorry, we'd have to wear badges or something. Don't you find it a problem continually being mistaken for each other?
Yeah, we do,
I guess. So.
I guess. But, I mean, we have a lot of laughs as well, don't we?
Oh, I think so, very much.
There's a very, very funny thing happened. We got on a tube and we swapped tickets and the conductor didn't even notice.
With a young team new to television, they needed at least one person with experience, and that came in the shape of the maverick, Chris Langham.
I thought I told you never to call me here. That's better. Good evening.
Chris was easily the most experienced person we had in the cast going into the main series. He'd worked with very good people. He understood the mechanics of comedy very well. He knew how timing and all that kind of thing worked in a way.
I mean, Chris Langham was very important to holding that series together, that first one, because he knew exactly what he was doing, you know. Written for Spike Milligan, done stuff with the Pythons, and really knew his way around. And I'd seen him being brilliant at the Edinburgh Fringe two or three years before. I mean, he was extraordinary.
Are you talking to me?
Anticipating the moment of attack.
Not yet.
Sorry. Exploit your opponent's momentum, converting a trip and a throw out of his attack. OK, now let's see what that really looks like.
All the show needed now was a funny woman to complete the lineup. Easier said than done.
There were very few women doing that kind of performing comedy. We talked to Victoria Wood, we talked to Susan George, if all people wanted to be in the show. Alison Steadman we offered it to and didn't want to do it. It was very hard to find people.
The funny woman they were looking for was making people laugh all over London. You just had to go to the right party.
For some reason, I found myself invited to a Sunday afternoon party with some friends in London, telling silly stories in my broad Australian accent.
Being whatever I was, 26, I spent the entire party machinating to try and get introduced to this girl, who was extraordinary. I mean, she was the most luminous person you've ever seen. You know, perfect figure and fantastic smile. And I saw her across the room and I just worked my way around. Hello, would you like to be on television, my dear?
And I thought, yeah. He just wants to get in my pants. And He asked me for my phone number, and I gave him my phone number because I actually thought he was quite cute. Then he actually did, surprise, surprise, call me up about work, and it was just work. And he called me into the BBC, and I auditioned for him and Sean Hardy.
Over the last 10 years, the Japanese have made huge strides in microtechnology, leaving Europe far behind. That is, until now. Because now a British company has come up with a microprocessor which is comparably effective. The chip, which is derived from an American design, is silicon-based and represents the single greatest British advance in microtechnology this century. But you see, it's not as small as the Japanese model.
You know, the whole thing was a kind of junior common room, student, Oxbridge-y type thing. And actually having Pamela, who was very much not part of that world, was a good thing, and I think it made it much more contemporary and much more sort of universal in its appeal.
I was into yin and yang and hatha yoga, ginseng and caraway seeds and being a non-smoker. My cauliflower quiches were better than the bought ones, and I wore thicker than two short ones.
When Pamela exploded onto the scene, she was very attractive. She was very sexy. And for the first time, you saw a sexy, attractive woman being funny.
Pamela had balls, and so I started writing for her. She wasn't just the pretty one, though she was, but she was really funny. So she kind of broke the mold a little bit of being really that attractive, but she could do it.
Yeah, oh, that is great. Okay, now give me that one again. Yeah, oh, yeah, these are going to look really good. We're nearly there, okay? Okay, now give me that big one. Yeah, okay, got it, yeah.
The search was over. Here they were. It was all looking good. Sort of.
We had this famous lunch, and I'm sitting there thinking, I can't imagine what I've done here. I've made the most horrible mistake, because at the lunch were Sean Hardy, a very bright current affairs director, never worked in comedy, Rowan Atkinson, a painfully shy electronic engineer from Newcastle, hardly said a word all through lunch, Mel Smith, the man with the hedgy haircut, strange haircut, Chris Langham, this sort of haunted looking, you know, somebody looked like he did sort of took a lot of stuff in the evenings. And Pamela Stevenson, this kind of, you know, goddess, unbelievably pretty. And me, and I'm thinking, apart from a skip out of the back of Madame Tussauds, I can't think of a more weird collection of people just to look at them. It was the most uncomfortable lunch. We had absolutely nothing to say to each other. And rehearsal started, you know, a couple of days later. And it was very, very awkward indeed.
The oddball collection of people that was Not the 9 o'clock News hit our screens on October the 16th, 1979.
I am God, the Father Almighty.
Why don't you piss off?
What do you like doing in your spare time?
Screwing.
Have you got something about that long? sort of that thick? Made of wax?
Yeah.
Well, you better light it, then we're cutting your electricity off.
We had the most bizarre things in the first series. Like, where four or five people sit inside a gigantic mouth. I remember that. I mean, why? I've got no idea. I think it was our way of doing topicality or something, or what's on everyone's lips. Anyway, they built this gigantic mouth with the four of us sitting in it, just basically trying to be satirical. It was appalling.
Right, it's this big one at the front, is it? I think it's working for Linda Lovelace, eh?
Look, could we get on, please? We must think of something to say.
It was a completely awful idea, but we tried not to be like the two Ronnies, and after 2 weeks we dropped it, burned the set, and had two people sitting behind a desk, and it worked much better.
Back home again now, and Prime Minister Mrs. Thatcher spent the weekend quietly relaxing at Chequers and reading some of her fan mail.
The
dispute, and in a magnificent show of defiance, British Rail's chief, Sir Peter Parker, ignored an Asleff picket line yesterday and drove out a train himself.
Behind a desk, you got a lot on your side. Yeah, I mean, you really have. It's like, this is official. No matter how daft the thing you're about to say, I mean, it places it. And, of course, that gave it its link back to what the real 9 o'clock news would be like.
Following his speech to the House of Commons on the outcome of the embassy siege, Mr. William Whitelaw has been admitted to hospital for medical checks. Doctors are concerned about the size of his head.
Pamela Stevenson had found her place in the show and never looked back.
You know, she was originally hired as just a, you know, cool actress, and then she started doing these weird voices. You think, God, she is a bit nuts, you know. What's that weird voice she's doing now as the newsreader? And you think, have I heard that before? You shut your eyes. My God, it's Angela Rippon.
The West German Chancellor, Herr Schmidt, has today announced measures designed to bring full employment to Europe, create closer ties between the Allies, and provide a welcome slap in the face for Russian expansionism. He's invaded Czechoslovakia.
I was asked to be a generic newsreader, but I'd hardly heard any newsreaders. I think the only one I'd really heard was Angela Rippon. So when I started doing a newsreader, it sounded like Angela. And then we decided to really go for it. And then I studied her and tried to make myself look like her.
There, she goes. After she's finished a sentence, she goes, and she looks down and she goes, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da.
So I just took it a little bit further. So instead of guerrilla, it was guerrilla.
Another of Mr. Mugabe's guerrilla commanders has been refused service in a Salisbury hotel for not wearing a tie. The manager was later sacked for not wearing a head.
I loved the way that she would push her impersonations to a slightly grotesque place. They were very funny. I think, did she hold Jan Leeming's hands like that?
She had the hands like that. And then, of course, the earrings got bigger and bigger and bigger. But the hands, I thought, I don't sit like that.
Golf. And there was excitement at the Harrogate and District Pro-Am tournament yesterday when a competitor insisted on playing the ball after the umpire had declared it out of bounds.
She got the overall impression. I mean, she got the hair, obviously, and, I mean, the earrings were... Well, that was a touch of genius.
Each week, the show took real television news film and ripped it apart. It was then put back together to look like no news you'd ever seen before.
It's God bless America, Mr. President.
God bless America.
What I wanted to do was to say that people, things are not always as they appear to be. And that's why we messed with news film and things like that. That's to tell people just to look at things from another angle.
It was fun to think that, you know, nobody's that clever, nobody's that beyond criticism, you know.
Lord Great Chamberlain, with his white staff, gives the sign for the procession to turn and for the fanfare from the trumpeters.
And that's such an important part of what not the 9 o'clock news became. That just that, you know, that notion of funny things against real footage, you know.
People looked forward to those elements in the show every week.
The first series was hit and miss, and the TV critics didn't like it at all.
I certainly remember reading a lot of reviews at the end of the first series which said, nice try, but don't bother again.
Several viewers who phoned the Mirror used the word disgusting.
Rarely have I seen a programme containing so much violence and hatred towards society in general.
It is the most obscene programme I have ever seen. If the BBC want to corrupt the young, they are going the right way about it.
Monday's offering was designed to offend almost everyone.
I was utterly ashamed and disgusted by Not the 9 O'Clock News.
First series of Not the 9 O'Clock News, I mean, never got above a million, never. And was absolutely ripped to pieces by everybody who wrote TV criticism. In fact, just in general, we were a disaster area.
Oh, it's terrible, isn't it? Terrible. I've been on this programme 15 months, I've been here. I've done every single goddamn programme, you know. And I think it's awful.
There was something not quite right with the show. And the finger of blame was pointing at Chris Langham.
Well, Sean and John came to see me one day in the office to express their worries about Chris, in the sense that he was a formidable character and he was disproportionately affecting the balance of the comedic structure of the programme.
Every day, Chris would say, let's do this, let's do that, come on, yeah, we can save that one, do this one, and the others just found themselves working on stuff they didn't like hugely.
I mean, he would go over the top occasionally because he had the confidence to do so. He'd been in it much longer than any of us, don't forget. I mean, Chris must have been 5 or 6 years older than any of us and had much, much more experience. But the wedge, I'm pretty certain, was between Chris and John Lloyd.
He was a difficult guy. I mean, he was under the influence a good deal of the time, and I can say this because he's been in AA for years, and he was a very manipulative person. His addictions produced him a kind of paranoia, which enabled him to try and destabilize any situation he was in, and it was very hard working with him.
Do you find it visible? Will I say the name? Dickus. Dickus.
Chris Langham's appearance in Monty Python's Life of Brian would unexpectedly bring the tension to crisis point.
Go away!
The film stirred up a huge controversy, and Not the 9 O'Clock News were quick to exploit the angry debate.
Oh, come now, Bishop. I mean, the leading figure in this film, what is it? Jesus Christ. I mean, it's quite clearly a lampoon of the comic messiah himself, our Lord John Cleese. I mean, well, come on, I mean, even the initials, JC, are exactly the same.
I remember the joy of discovering that Jesus Christ and John Cleese have the same initials. And therefore, that can form the basis of an argument that someone can put in the sketch. It was very, very pleasing, that.
There had been this gloriously pompous debate between two of the Pythons and Malcolm Muggeridge and the Bishop as to whether it was blasphemous or not.
When I look at their figure, I mean, I know you're going to say Brian isn't Jesus, but I mean, that's just rubbish.
You keep making the basic assumption that we are ridiculing Christ and Christ's teaching, and I say that we are not.
Oh, I mean, what you were saying, it's a great bit of sheer rubbish.
Chris was very unhappy with the Life of Python sketch. He felt that it wasn't the kind of thing we should be doing, that it was incestuous, and it was a kind of a very awkward moment in the history of the programme, that, I think, that whole question of where we were going and what we could and couldn't do.
I must explain to you, the Christ figure is not Cleese.
Oh, come on.
No, he's just an ordinary man who happens to have been born in Weston-super-Mare at the same time as Mr. Cleese.
Jonathan,
he is mistaken for the comic messiah himself by vast crowds of people who follow him about, doing silly walks, shouting, no, no, not the comfy chair.
Well, Alexander Walker, the final scene of the picture has attracted the most attention.
Right, well, I mean, now here, I think we have the ultimate blasphemy. I mean, it is set in a hotel in Torquay where literally hundreds of Spanish waiters are being clipped about the ear by this Jesus Christ bloke. It is obviously a lampoon of the
Comic Messiah's greatest half hour.
It's not at all. The point.
It's Torbay.
Thank you both very much.
Oh, come on, Torbay, Torquay. I mean,
Bishop,
we're quibbling.
Alexander Walker, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much.
Life of Python was it started to gel. You could see that there was respect between the actors, respect of the actors for the writers, and an ability to let the production go to the producers, and we all started to believe in each other, and it's this extraordinary chemistry happened. It was very, very exciting and different, and none of us could think of any sketch that had ever been quite like it. And Chris was resentful, I think. I think he sort of slightly thought he'd lost control at that point, and he had.
A defining moment in the story of Not the 9 o'clock News had been reached. Something had to be done.
It was a period of his own life where he was in a bit of a mess anyway, I think, which didn't help. There was a fair amount of drinking drugs going on, which kind of didn't help matters. We could never make up our minds whether to keep him in the cast or not. John and I agonised about it for ages and ages and ages, and in the end were told to get rid of him.
I didn't know what I was supposed to do, and I didn't want to sack him. That's the thing, and I let it drift, and then we just, like, you know, he just wasn't asked back, and that wasn't a good thing at all. I'm not in the least bit proud of it.
So we were cowardly and did it badly.
The only man brave enough to give Langham the bad news was the BBC's head of comedy, John Howard Davis.
He came in and sat down on the sofa, and I said, I'm afraid I'm going to have to ask you to leave the series. And he said, why? And I explained as best I could, without actually offending him. I think Chris was in some doubt as to what had happened to him, whether he was being praised or fired. In fact, it was the latter.
Not the 9 o'clock News now turned to the man who had just been a bit part player in Series 1. He had everything they were looking for. He was young and funny. He had been in the Cambridge footlights. He had three names. He was Griff Rhys Jones.
Hello.
Griff was obviously going to be famous from the first day I knew him. The first day I saw Griff, I thought, this guy is going to be so famous. Long before it's when I was a student actor and just saw him in a play.
Oh, I remember being quite jealous of Griff, because Griff had this ability to make John absolutely pee himself with laughter by his facial expressions. I mean, Griff would kind of tense up all his muscles and make this face, and I remember a lot of the rehearsal was spent with John absolutely just dying with laughter.
Me and my mates, right, like, we went down Brighton the weekend, right, and we were in Mudge down there, right, and I hate Mudge because they make me puke, right, so I goes down there, right, with my mate, and old Les, he's got the old pickaxe handle, right, and I've got the old bicycle chain, right, like that, you know, so we start doing them, right, you know, and these two other ones, they got me down an alleyway, but I had an old fork stuffed up my pullover, you know, and I got it really bad.
With Griff Rhys Jones in place, they were finally ready for takeoff.
I remember Griff ever doing formal impressions of famous people, which he started doing with his Donald Sinden impression in Series 1, and then, of course, discovered this amazing gift for it.
What do you mean? I'm a famous English actor, and I've come here tonight to this church.
Finally, were the Lambeth poisoners, also responsible for a string of bank raids in July 1979?
No.
I can give you some help here. Nice hotel in Rio, change of identity protection, 60,000 to secret bank account.
Yeah, they did it. Yeah.
Cereal.
I'm indebted to a gentleman from Swansea who wrote to tell me that his television entertainment is constantly ruined by the appearance of a camp old twat who continuously reads his appalling drivel over the air.
I think a lot of Griff's comedic charm, it was his boyishness, his pudginess. He was a bit like me in that he would sort of do anything for a laugh.
Don't slurp your orange juice.
What did you say?
I've told you before not to slurp your orange juice.
You cannot be serious! You cannot be serious! I did not slurp my orange juice!
It was quite a classic sketch at the time. It was, yes, McEnroe having breakfast. I cannot believe it. You cannot be serious.
For a very learned man, a very wise man, a man who you frankly cannot get to shut up about stuff a lot of the time because he knows so much about everything, he played Moron very, very well. And he, like, half of his characters seemed to be that. That was that Griff Rhys Jones acting masterclass. That was a large part of it.
Some of these cases are just plain stupid. Looking at me in a funny way. Is this some kind of joke, Savin?
No, sir.
And we have some more here. Walking on the cracks in the paper. Walking in a loud shirt in a built-up area during the hours of darkness. And walking around with an offensive wife.
Savage was a corker. Yeah, it was great.
I mean, very good at, you know, being a bit like that. Rome was brilliant, and it was just a great idea, wasn't it?
Savage, why do you keep arresting this man?
He's a villain, sir.
A villain?
And a jailbird, sir.
I know he's a jailbird, Savage. He's down in the cells now. We're holding him on a charge of possession of curly black hair and thick lips.
Well, there you are, sir.
You arrested him, Savage.
Thank you, sir.
Griff's arrival as a full-time member of the team luckily coincided with the weird goings-on in pop music videos that was the new romantic movement.
Nice video showing about the song sums up the song. I mean, the video itself became a mammoth industry suddenly, and all sorts of directors started making their name producing this flamboyant crap.
The videos themselves that we were parodying were already almost beyond parody. So actually to make it, actually to show people you're making fun of it and not just doing another one was the task.
The devil's lunar craft makes waves in time. My Asian brother says, spare me a dime.
I mean, I think the session where Griff put the vocal on was one of the funniest 3 hours of my life. Something about his innocence of singing madly on the middle of that track and the madness of the video that makes it, I think, very funny.
Oh, I thought I sang it quite well.
The songs came thick and fast. I Like Trucking was another one that hit the right spot. Good news for Rowan, bad news for hedgehogs.
Rowan absolutely loved it because he got to drive an HGV. And, you know, he's one of the only comics that I'm aware of who's got an HGV license. It was absolutely fantastic for Rowan. I mean, brilliant. I mean, it was, you couldn't get him out of the bloody lorry, I tell you.
I can't remember whether it was because they knew I had an HGV license or because I made the suggestion myself that the I Like Trucking song was contrived. And it was a thoroughly enjoyable day.
It was rather a jolly tune. It was very funny. I mean, it had no real point to it other than the fact that they run over hedgehogs.
On screen, it was clear the programme had a winning formula, but it was off screen with the release of the records and books which confirmed that the show was now big news.
The Not Life of News book came out. We went to Oxford to sign it in the Penguin bookshop, and the queue for people who had come to sign this, to get their copy of this book, stretched all the way down Oxford High Street. We just sat there, we're going like this, signing these ruddy books one after the other, and people filed past all morning buying these books.
And they had to send off to London for lorry loads of books, small books, to be delivered so that we could sign for this massive crowd that had appeared.
You suddenly find that your album's gone double platinum and you've knocked Queen off the top of the charts. You kind of go, good Lord. Do you mean 600,000 people last week bought the album? That album's success gave us a check each that was, in those days, beyond the dreams of Croesus. I think we got something like, I don't know, I can't remember, something like 25 grand each. And I'd ring up my mum and dad and say, hey, guess what? I just got a check for this, that, or the other. And they couldn't believe it. And I couldn't either.
Suddenly the royalties started to come in because the record sales were quite bizarrely large. And my predominant thought was probably, which model of Aston Martin will this buy me? I suspect that was my priority when looking at a large cheque. It was always immediately cars that would sort of flash into my head, thinking I could just about run to the V8.
It was quite a staggering sum of money. And I remember going to see my agent. He said to me, they've asked if you want to do another one of these record things. Are you interested in doing that? Because you did the first one without, before you joined me. And I said, yes. He said, did he make you any money? I said, well, about £30,000. And he fell off his... I've never seen anybody actually do that. I've never seen anybody... What?
The show was now at the peak of its popularity, and the hits just kept on coming. Everything was super duper.
One of us is ugly, one of us is cute. One of us you'd like to see in her birthday suit. Two of us write music, two of us have song. Sorry in translation, that line come out wrong. But still super duper, it's super duper that we're number one again. Singing super duper duper makes us super duper.
The pressure and the agony and the struggle and all the difficulty is repaid by ludicrous success. I mean, fantastic acclaim.
Their figures, I don't know what they were, but I guess they were in the very high millions, in up to 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 million, which are now unthinkable figures.
Not the 9 o'clock news was the hit comedy show of the day. The books and records were flying off the shelves and the awards piled up for the whole team. Especially for the star of the show, Rowan Atkinson.
Most of the last year of my life has been spent working on a notorious programme called Not the 9 O'Clock News. And I'd really like to devote this award as much to myself as to Mel Smith and Griffith Jones and Pamela Stevenson and to our two producers, our two relatively unsung heroes, John Lloyd and Sean Hardy, without whose extraordinary producing talents really the programme would never have happened.
Earlier today, we had Game for a Laugh, came round to his house and cut his wife's head off. Now, I hear through my ears that Jeffrey's just coming round the corner, so let's see if Jeffrey Lewis's Game for a Laugh.
Yes, I think he's found her. Let's go and see if Jeffrey Lewis's Game for a Laugh. Come on. Hello, Jeffrey.
Oh, God! Oh, God!
Jeffrey, can I ask you why you're looking so perturbed?
My wife! The head!
Right.
You knew?
Yes, Jeffrey, we knew. But what you didn't know was that a couple of weeks ago, your wife rang us up and said you'd be the sort of fella who was... came for a laugh.
Oh, I don't believe it. Oh, great.
Yeah.
Oh, this is unbelievable. I mean, you guys cut a head off.
That's right.
And I came out and you watched. What a bunch of loonies.
Great.
It was the most successful comedy show in years. But keeping it going put more pressure on some than others.
It was a nightmare of overwork. I mean, everything was stressful. We used to be green with exhaustion. We were, you know, within an ace of disaster more or less every week.
I thought it was very disorganized. We were kind of making it up as we went along.
We did this insane weekly turnaround. The show would go out on a Monday night. On Tuesday, we would have the script meeting.
Within a week, you've started from no script to a recorded, edited program and a transmission in a single week.
The Not the 9 O'Clock News was in a real, a vortex of filth and grayness and, you know, teacups and men who hadn't shaved. It wasn't beautiful the way, you know, you see these, you know, sexy offices and, you know, people coming down with trays of things. I don't remember eating. And it was like being in a boy's dorm.
My major memory of the show is sitting in a basement in Camden Town, writing lots and lots and lots. Sometimes, of course, you'd watch a show and there'd be almost nothing by you.
It is miraculous what we did, and it was only we were able to do it by basically going without sleep for about 3 months. But for the actors, it was a very nice job.
My job on Not I was felt was quite straightforward, that I just turned up and learnt the scripts and turned up on the Sunday and recorded them. It seemed like a very simple job.
There was always work going on because there would be a series of sketches that needed to be done. And John would want to rehearse something with whoever was in it, and the rest of us would read the newspapers and fiddle around with scripts that we were trying to work on, or play pinball. A lot of pinball.
It was partly the joy of having a big, flashing, colourful thing that you knew nobody else had, you know. The Roy Castle special certainly didn't have a pinball machine.
It was amazing. The energy and the fire and the creative enthusiasm in the room when they were playing pinball was devastating. And then they'd say, we'd better go back to the sketches, and everybody would go, just waiting for something funny to be said.
And a very good evening to you. You join us during the final stages of this truly titanic struggle between Die Fat Belly Gut Bucket and the English champion Tommy Even Fatter Belly Belcher. And it's all down now to this last leg, and it's Fat Belly on the hockey.
Game on.
So it's Fat Belly to go first. And it's a good start. Double vodka. Single pint. Another double vodka.
100 milligrams.
100 milligrams. That's a good start for Fat Belly.
The writers kept the flow of good ideas coming, but in the cut and thrust of the script meetings, some of the best ones nearly didn't make it.
I remember John saying, when I handed in the bit of paper saying, Rowan walks along the street, sees a camera, and hits a lamppost, saying, one, it's not funny, and two, you don't expect me to pay you for that.
I turned over the page as a kind of interesting setup. What's the joke? And he said, well, that's the joke. I said, well, I don't know why you'd... You can imagine, I probably got a bit cross because, you know, we're all under such pressure all the time. You think, you know, what the hell is this, Richard? You know, there's got no joke in it. He said, no, please, can we try it? And Rowan's very keen to try it.
It was just something that felt funny, a sort of gimpish self-consciousness.
And, of course, an idiot that one is, the minute you see it on camera, you go, oh, what a fool. Of course, it's brilliant.
You know, the sweet reaction of the self-conscious man who has no performing talent, per se. It's just, you know, what do you do if you notice someone, oh, you know, I'm not sure where to put myself, and so inevitably, you know, you're going to hit something eventually.
It's not about bumping into the tree. It's about the vanity of looking into the camera, and then you don't pay attention because you think, oh, look, I'm being filmed. And it's absolutely charming. Of course, probably the single most famous Not the 9 O'Clock News sketch there is. So, Bully for me just shows how useless I was.
We tried to work out things which were odd and which Rowan and I would sort of do more on stage rather than writing satirical things about, you know, trade unions or train timetables or stuff like that.
Good evening, sir.
May I take your coat for you?
Please, yes.
Would you like me to take your jacket for you?
Yes, please. Yes.
Now, Rowan is a complete performer. I mean, everything's important, you know, the size of the shot, the body position, you know, the tiny little tics of the face, the timbre of the voice, the pauses, you know, everything, the lines, you know, and as we know, Rowan can do an awful lot of things just by going several times, or going bob, or gramophone.
Excuse me.
Yeah?
I wonder if you could help me, please. I want to buy a gramophone.
A what?
A gramophone.
Gramophone.
A gramophone.
I don't think we've got any gramophones here, Grandad.
Because his comedy seems to come from his physical presence, his body, his face, his limbs, his and his voice.
So you got your deck,
right?
Do you want a Dolby with it?
Yes, please.
You only had Dolby's with tape recorders, Chief. All right. Do you want an amp?
No, I won't.
You won't hear anything, Grandad, without an amp, I'm afraid.
Oh, so, of course, yes, I want an amp.
You want yes, an amp.
Yes,
all right, what sort of output are you looking for?
What sort have you got?
No clues.
About medium?
How many watts, exactly?
Oh, I should think about three. No, 2,000. 500.
30. So you know all about it now, don't you? You want a 30-watt amp?
A 30-watt amp.
Do you want speakers?
Yes.
Do you want rumble filters?
Yes.
Do you want a bag on your head?
Yes.
It was nothing like him on the television at the time. There was no one as funny bones, no one as innate, no one as just... You cannot take your eyes off him because he will... do that dopey face, that thing, and you will want to watch that.
A flashbulb suspended here to be connected to an aerial receiver here. So now, when this discreet accessory is worn, even a deaf person knows when the phone is ringing.
I remember practicing in front of a mirror. I remember when I sort of first discovered, you know, how extreme my facial expressions could be for comic effect, and practicing them and thinking, gosh, that looks pretty funny to me. I think I'll try that tomorrow night in front of a paying audience and see how they react.
A runny nose cannot be prevented, but it can now be cured. Contact 1200 for fast, effective, painful relief.
Rowan, Mel, Pamela and Griff were now television stars, and their lives were changing fast. They were young and funny, but now they were also rich and famous.
It's wonderful to have a sort of the wind in your sails, you know. It's wonderful. And you think, yeah, why not, actually? Why not?
There's nothing better than being 26, 27, and being able to walk into a room and everybody turns around and goes, there he is, look at his room.
Good evening, Smarm, Smarm. Very good to be here with you again. And tonight I'm grovelling to one of the most extraordinary, how should I put it, Smarm, Smarm, performers of our generation. Ladies and gentlemen, tonight I'm grovelling to Billy Connolly.
The appearance on the show of the very famous Billy Connolly started off as a day of mutual admiration between showbiz chums, but soon turned into a major life-changing event.
Scotsmen, drunk Scotsmen, especially drunk Glaswegians, walk with one leg. And they ask everybody if they're all right all the time. Yeah, right?
Billy was a phenomenon in those days. Billy was the only... I mean, now that we're used to the idea of stand-up comedians traipsing around England and filling halls, nobody did that. Billy Connolly did it. He was the only person who did it. He would go around Britain like a rock star, playing these massive halls to huge acclaim as principally the only sort of stand-up comedian of his kind in the country. And so we were in awe of him. We worshipped him.
One of the first things I did was with Rowan Atkinson. He interviewed me like a Parkinson kind of guy, but the whole theme was that I was working class and interesting, and he was a toff and deeply and very patronising. You know, and I remember him saying he was going grovel, grovel. He kept saying grovel, and then he said, "And you come from Glasgow?" And I said, "Yeah." And he said, "Oh, Glasgow, gorbals, gorbals, grovel, grovel."
Right, well, let's get down to you. Apparently you were born on your kitchen floor. How interesting, how interesting.
Yeah. Well, we just moved to the Gorbals at the time.
Oh, grovel, grovel, gobble, grovel.
But I had a hugely high opinion of them, and they were flying. They were rock and roll, you know. And when they did private appearances, the streets were jammed with people, you know. So they were big, big news.
We asked Billy Connolly to be on the show because I really wanted him to get married to Pamela. I'll say no more about that.
Well, I didn't really know who Billy was, because I was, you know, just this young Australian who I hadn't really seen him at all. I mean, I'd actually never seen him.
Hey, you.
Right.
Has Jimmy Chainsaw McPhee been in here tonight?
No.
What about Big Jock the Knee Cruncher?
No.
What about stick the boot in his head and ask questions later, McDonald?
No.
Hacksaw Haggerty the Hen Choker?
No.
Can I have a companion thunder, please? We got to the rehearsal room and I saw... I was in a corridor and they were in a room. They'd been rehearsing for a while when I arrived. And there was a doorway and Pamela came past the door on a tea trolley, like Superman, like horizontal on the top. And I thought, this is different.
I mean, he was just this huge Scottish beast. I mean, I thought he was some kind of animal. And, he ate his meal, the fish meal, with his hands. He didn't pick up a knife and fork at any point. And actually, I thought that was rather attractive.
Well, hello. And tonight I'm talking to Billy Connolly, a well-known Scottish comedian.
He was absolutely brilliant, and you could see there was a chemistry with him and Pamela straight away, the swine.
When I look at that sketch, the Janet Street Porter one, I can definitely see a spark between us that was more than just a comic spark.
It was a love affair made in the Not the 9 o'clock News studio.
Billy, I understand that when you first came to England, people had a lot of trouble understanding your accent. Is that right?
Sorry?
The affair with Billy Connolly made Pamela Stevenson even more famous than she was before. Now Pamela was a new story herself.
Pamela went through, as you know, a sort of astral fame phase where she was probably the most famous woman in the country, along with Princess Diana, with whom she was quite friendly. And she was on the front page of the paper more or less every day.
Pam became a very big star very quickly, and often for... because she was a pretty woman, apart from being a very good performer. So she was very high profile in the tabloids and all the rest of it. And so she was caught between being very famous by that stage and also having to try to draw the borderline between that and her own private life and what was going on in her private life. So she was under a lot of pressure in that way, much more pressure than the boys were, really.
Pamela Stevens said to me once, she said, the first 6 months of being famous is like being totally high, like being on drugs on a skiing holiday, and the rest of it is just rubbish, it's awful.
Let me see your tongue, that's right, that looks nice.
It was definitely quite overwhelming, everything. I remember feeling very out of control.
Pamela Stevenson.
Parkey invited me to go on with Reggie Bosanquet, and I seem to remember sort of, I don't know, climbing on top of him at one point. I think I did something really pretty out there.
But it's not, you know, hang on.
I mean, if I was sort of...
Michael! Oh, my God.
I remember his toupee taking a full 360 turn at the time, and it, yeah, I don't know what I was thinking.
Michael, I didn't realise it was
that
kind of show.
You know, I mean, yeah, she was always getting into trouble by, you know, doing untoward things on Parkinson and, you know, slightly ill-judged, you know, piece of bad luck. But again, it was a lark, you know. What would have been very larky with your friends on a stag night or something, not necessarily acceptable on, you know, 10 o'clock on BBC One.
Pamela wasn't the only wild thing on TV in 1979. There was also David Attenborough's encounter with a gorilla on Life on Earth, which inspired a much weirder encounter on Not the 9 o'clock News.
Professor, can Gerald really speak as we would understand it?
Oh, yes, yes, yes. I mean, he can speak a few actual words. Of course, it was extremely difficult to get him even to this stage. When I first captured Gerald in the Congo, I'm 67, I think it was.
68.
He had a kind of strange, kind of off-key notion of a man who's been trying to raise a gorilla and has become, you know, obsessed and is clearly in love with this gorilla, but daren't say it.
Yes, I was going to ask you, actually. Gerald, do you have a mate?
Yeah, I've got lots of mates. There's the professor, there's his son Toby, there's Raymond next door.
Well, no, actually...
I see what you mean. Crumpet. Crumpet. Well...
You didn't tell me you were friendly with Raymond.
Well, do I have to tell you everything?
It's absolutely brilliant teamwork between the three of them, because Mel is playing a fantastic straight bass, a performer, and Pamela is brilliant. I mean, she's absolutely... That's wonderful acting. Those flat looks she gives as the interviewer, you know, thinking, you know, you can just see her brain going, this is going horribly wrong, you know, my television career's over. You can almost hear the producer in her ear shouting, get them off, get them off!
There was an awful lot of work to do. He was enormously slow and difficult. I had to do a lot of work with him on a sort of one-to-one basis.
If I might just butt in at this point, Tim, I think I should point out that I have done a considerable amount of work on this project myself, and if I may say so, your teaching methods do leave a bit to be desired. And your diction, for instance, is
I'm
not
sorry,
really
sorry, can I put this into some sort of perspective? When I caught Gerald in 68, he was completely wild.
Wild? I was absolutely livid.
God knows how you make that terrible gorilla costume look funny, because it's, you know, not wanting to knock what we could afford as a costume, but, you know, it really doesn't stand up as anything like the Planet of the Apes, does it?
But there was something in the body attitude that was perfectly possible to, you know, to convey while in a gorilla suit. And it was nice to discover that, you know, the body language could be, you know, could be heard.
Look, I know you've never got on with my mother.
Well, she didn't exactly like me, did she?
She got on perfectly well with David Attenborough.
David Attenborough! All I ever hear is David bloody Attenborough!
Let Dave out of this, will
you? Oh, shut up and have a banana.
All right, I will.
I remember that I couldn't see the plate, and I couldn't feel my mouth. It was a very difficult, physically very challenging sketch.
The programme had gained a reputation for being edgy and outrageous. Every week, they were accused of going too far. But when complaints started coming from other comedians, it was time to fight back.
There were quite a lot of snide remarks used to go on about how Not the 9 o'clock News was rude and juvenile and, you know, how pathetic it was and shouldn't be allowed. And I think Ronnie Barker was not averse to dropping those sort of remarks.
A tragic accident has ended the career of Plastix, the amazing Plastic Man. He sat on a radiator today and made a complete pool of himself.
I went through a whole episode of The Two Ronnies, counting all the rude jokes. There were 54 rude jokes in half an hour. They were just unbelievably smutty. But they posed as this thing that they weren't rude because they disguised it and we were rude because we actually said bloody rather than ruddy.
I had a nice little donkey. I fed it on nettles and grass. One day my donkey went wonky, and now I can't sit on my ass.
I mean, we were all sick of old school comedians pretending to almost say a rude word and then not saying it. And, you know, while Ronnie Barker is a legend, you know, it's not the greatest comedy device in the world to almost say poo.
The Not the 9 o'clock News team didn't have to wait long before a chance came to show Ronnie Barker just how far the rudeness envelope could be pushed.
Good evening. It's wonderful to be with you again, isn't it, Ronnie?
No, it's a bleeding pain in the arse, frankly. But in a packed programme tonight, you'll be reassured to know we'll be using exactly the same sort of material
as we've used for the last 20 years.
In the fourth series, we had this brilliant sketch from a guy who was a disaffected to Ronnie's writer. And it was an absolute assassination thing, which is to say, when he says cobblers, I mean testicles, and so on. And it was a brilliant destruction of the two Ronnies.
Later in the show, I shall be implying through smutty innuendo
that I have a very small part
and I have an enormous penis.
They basically called the bluff of innuendo, and the two Ronnies chose to be very offended by this.
Well, what we did was just to say, this is what it would sound like if they actually said what they were pretending they were saying.
And all the way through the show, he shall frequently cry.
Spectacles?
By which he means testicles.
Cobblers?
By which he means testicles.
Didgeridoos?
By which he means penises.
Watermelons?
Breasts.
Articles?
Testicles again.
Bristles?
Breasts again.
And bouncers?
Breasts or testicles.
I mean, the two Ronnies always ended with a big musical number where they basically sort of marked time and did sort of silly rhymes, marching up and down upon the spot, spot, spot.
They are driving us bats.
You see, I used to love the scene. It was just a bit old-fashioned, and in the way that, you know, young people, as we were in those days, have to, you know, sort of slag those things off, and so we did. Slag them we did.
We like birds, we're ornithologists, ornithologists. I got a nice pair of binoculars. You can stick them up on your tripod.
It was quite malicious, actually. It's quite funny. It's about the choreography. We're marching up and down upon the spot, 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 because the sodding choreographers are top, top, top.
I couldn't care a jot if we're military men or not. With a bum, how's your father? Honestly, I don't care. Just crawling through the grass, thistles in me hair, and bracken up the anus. I'm through to bits if I see a pair of tits. And I love to watch the sun go down. Oh, vagina, oh, vagina, oh, vagina.
And poor old Ronnie Barker saw this and thought, OK, what bastards.
I mean, he hated it. And he was what they call in the BBC. There's always, at any time, the BBC have a thing called the governor. Well, he was the governor in those days, you know, and he had a lot of clout. Although, all power to everyone's elbow, it went out and that was it. Sorry if it offends you, but there you go, you know. Ronnie Corbett loved it.
Chair off the rank and the titty bum urals nibbling away with a pain in the Vulcan. Spotty potty wee wee piddling about in the Jimmy Riddle Candy Licker Orchestra. Knickers up and down to me, willy bum gooly, knockers of the mammary, nympho beaver. Knackers in the Baltic, clappering away, so we knicker and we knacker and we knocker all day. Knickers up and down to me, willy bum gooly, knockers of the mammary, nympho beaver. Knackers in the Baltic, clappering away, so we knicker and we knacker and we knocker and we knacker and we knicker and we knacker and we knocker all day.
I didn't want to do it at the time anyway. Not because I just didn't see what the big satirical edge was in having a go at the two Ronnies.
Griff, I think, met Ronnie Corbett at a party and he said, you know, we shouldn't make jokes about Ronnie Corbett. He's lovely. He's very nice. And I thought, that's when I knew I'd lost everybody, you know, that you are, the famous are different from us.
The Fab Four had gone from a tight-knit team of unknowns to a collection of ambitious stars with big career plans.
Rowan, who was the only real technologist amongst us, said, we really ought to do a video from this. So he said, I'll get some video time and I'll cut together a 90-minute special from all the best sketches. And so he took months and months doing this and eventually called me and said, would you have a look? You know, what do you think? I'm quite pleased. So I went and saw this 90-minute video and I watched it right the way through and I said, Rowan, where's Pamela? He said, Pamela? He said, yes, she doesn't appear to be in it at all. I mean, he managed to take out every frame of Pamela. There wasn't one sketch or song with her in it. He said, I never really thought she was that funny. I said, yes, but Rowan, you know, she's one of four, but you can't. So that never saw the light of day, but that was how strongly he felt, I think. There wasn't a lot of love lost between them towards the end.
There were rumours of various misunderstandings, shall we put it, between the female and male members of the cast. And I think they became a bit of a more formidable problem as time went on.
I think there was a lot of strain in there as well. You know, there's a lot of stress and strain between people, individuals, you know, bits of jealousy and all that crap that goes on in shows like that.
I was always a bit too much of a sex pot or something, you know. I just, you know, I was always sort of interested in being attractive. And you have to kind of drop that when if you want to be matey with the boys and get on with them. And I think they were understandably a bit wary of me.
I think it was a bit electric in there. Yeah, even when I was working with them, you could see the shape of it, you know, and the way they hung out physically, you know. They were there and he was there and she was there. You could see the shape of it all.
It happens with bands, it happens with most performing teams that you, you know, it starts off tentatively, you get a period of time, it's only a matter of time where it's all gelling and then things start breaking down.
Dennis, wilt thou leave this woman who is thy wedded wife? Dost thou dislike her, despise her, hate the sight of the moth-eaten Snoopy doll she's had since college, and despise her brother, the chartered surveyor, who invites himself for dinner and drinks thy scotch after you've gone to bed? Dost thou dislike her mother, hate her cooking, get irritated that she picks at her toenails in bed, and that the clippings somehow find their way into that little crack in the side of the duvet? And wilt thou forsake her for as long as ye both shall live?
I will.
Muriel, wilt thou leave this drunken shit who is thy widow?
Not the 9 o'clock news had reached the top of the comedy hill. They were now faced with a big decision. Take it to the next level or quit while they were ahead.
We had an empire here, we had a franchise. And what I wanted to do was break into America. And I wanted to do movies. And I wanted to, to make something that would last forever. Sean and I asked the cast, the four cast, to dinner. And with the proposal we were going to make was that we were going to do exactly what the Pythons had done, which is they started Monty Python Productions. And then we would go on doing as we'd done. Very successful books. I mean, you know, one of the books sold 1 million copies. The Not the 9 o'clock News books were very successful in their own right. And Rowan said, these are not his words, but they were the words of Richard Armitage, his agent of whom I spoke earlier, the man with the huge cigar, who said to him, I don't think you should play with the second 11 anymore. And that's what Rowan passed on to us, that he said, I've talked to my agent, and he thinks that I shouldn't play with the second 11 anymore. And he's prefaced it by saying, you're all very nice people, and I like you a great deal, and you're all very talented.
I remember thinking, gosh, there are people here with stronger ambitions to be these big international stars than I.
Rowan then left the restaurant and everybody else got fantastically drunk because we all thought, right, that's the end of our career, basically, and had to go in the next day and be polite to each other in rehearsal, which was pretty tricky.
It was rather weird when it all finished. It was sort of, oh, right, what do we do now? I'd left the BBC. No job. I seriously did not know what I was supposed to do.
Retrospectively, I'd like to apologise for my high-handed attitude towards the whole thing.
You know, you won't get Rowan being rude to people. He doesn't do rude to people. He was passing on a remark from somebody else.
It would have been an odd thing had he stayed in a topical weekly TV show forever. It would have been odd. You're talking much more kind of Chaplin, Jacques Tati type character, and that would needed to have found a bigger, wider stage to play on, and boy, did he find a wider stage to play on.
That's the end of this series. Looks as though we're all going our separate ways now. We've had some good times and some bad times, haven't we, Mel?
Yes, Ryan, we have.
It's very easy to be very glib, you know, when you're in the middle of something like that and it's been very successful and you just kind of go, do you know something? I think I'll move on. You know, it never makes sense to the public, does it? That kind of thing, ever.
I remember it was more of a relief to her than a heartbreak when it ended. But that's been my experience of people in shows like that. People in television shows, when it ends, often there's a great relief to everybody. Sometimes it isn't later on, but with Pamela it was, it just continued to be a relief. I think she was glad to see the back of it.
I think I was ready to move on by the time I heard that it was over. I mean, it was kind of, people were going their different way. We were all tired.
I think it stopped at the right time. I think if you're going to carry on with that idea, you have to do something a little different. Either you have to bring, you know, new people in, or lose some people, or both, or take in a different direction, or try and do something different.
Not the 9 o'clock news had come to an end. The cast would perform together for one last time at the Theatre Royal, Drury Lane. When they walked off stage on the final night, it was all over. But not the 9 o'clock news had left its mark, and no one would ever forget it.
My hope is that when people watch it, they're surprised by how funny it is, and that their memory when they did watch it was that it was funny, and that I hope it's still, some of it holds up.
Wild. I was absolutely livid.
The show is as much part of me as it is of Pamela. Although she was the show and I was only a wee guest, but without the show, my life wouldn't have changed so radically. It's a hugely important part of my life.
It seems like kind of I went out on a long bender, do you know? It was a glorious bender I went out on 30 years ago.
As a producer, I say, try not to have any ego about my own work. Of course, it's fantastically flawed. If you probably couldn't watch a whole episode all the way through without cringing with embarrassment, but there's enough in it to say, yeah, pretty damn good.
I look back on it with great affection. Yeah, it was an innocent time and a carefree time. It was the fact that, you know, that's what I liked the most, really, was the fact that creatively, you know, there were many, many different styles and tones of comedy in there, and I enjoyed them all.
I don't think we realised just how good it was at the time. We knew it was successful, but did we think we'd be talking about it 30 years later? Absolutely not.
It was the show you wanted to watch. It was a great, funny show, and it was iconoclastic and all the rest of it. And that, and satirical, sorry, it was great. And to be part of it was the best time to be alive ever.
I know that looking back now, if I watch an old sketch or a bunch of old sketches, I know that I think it's a very, very good programme, which is something one should be very careful about thinking. But I think it was brilliant. You know, we all have our moment in the sun, I think. And we have one, that's for sure.
I never thought it would come to this, saying cunnilingus and then walking away. But at least it's better than saying goodbye, because goodbye is the hardest word to say. So we sing cunnilingus, we've had some fun. But what's done is done. Cunnilingus, you'll soon find someone new who'll never say cunnilingus to you. Cunnilingus.
Cunnilingus, Mel.
Cunnilingus.
Cunnilingus, me old mate.
Goodbye.
And you can see an episode.